Hey guys, Mike here at Patriot Coin Rings. Okay, so I got a gentleman named John that had wrote to me on one of my previous YouTube channel comments that he had noticed the Presidium engraver that I had in the background, and no, I've never made a video on it. He was asking about how to use it, that he was just getting into coin ring making and he wanted to know how to engrave. So I thought I'd go ahead and make a video on using the Presidium. And you can purchase them on eBay. And there's no model number that I'm aware of, but this is the engraver. You might recognize that on eBay. Typically come from China, but it's a really, really good engraver. And the cheapest one, I mean, the most affordable, I should say, that I've come across, and it does a beautiful job. So I thought we'd do a little demonstration. All right, so I suppose this is more of a review than anything, so that I can show you how to use it. Like I said, it doesn't come with instructions, so let's go ahead and go over this as quickly as possible. The first thing that you're gonna notice is that at the top, this is an area where you put your ring, let's call them ring holders. I don't know what other name to give it, but basically these are going to hold the ring in place. Now, to open them and close them, I just use this little knob, and once you get your ring in there, you're going to put it in place. This little guy right here is controlled with this, so make sure that's not in the way where it's going to scratch your ring while you're putting it in place. Once it's in there, you're going to lock down your ring. Now, for now, we're going to go ahead and leave the ring out of there so I could give you a quick tutorial. Now, in the kit, it typically comes with about a half a dozen or so of these ring grabbers. And all these ring grabbers on both sides have different size notches inside of them. That's so that it accommodates all the different types of ring bands and ring sizes that are available. The one that I like using is the 8mm side, and that's because I don't buy my rings from other people, but rather I make my own rings. And I can tell you that typically my bands are about 8mm in size. Even if it was a little bit larger, you could go ahead and switch them out. Now, to do that, all I do is just unscrew this. They pull out. Don't try to slide it or anything. You can see these little notches in here. There's little pins that go through there, and it has to slide all the way out. You flip-flop it around to the opposite side, and you'll notice that this notch is considerably smaller than this side. I don't know if you can see that or not, but two different size notches. Okay, this device up here, let me go ahead and rotate that around. What that's for is, that's if you have a ring that has a gem on it. Now, let's say you have a ring that has a stone or a gem or a diamond. That's to actually crank down on top of it and hold it in place so that it doesn't come loose in the process. I personally work with handmade rings. I make coin rings, I make titanium, tungsten, and stainless steel is pretty much the materials that I use, and silver, I guess. Some gold, but nevertheless, I don't really do stones, or at least at this time in the last 7 years, I haven't. I kind of stay away from traditional bands. I'm doing more things like what I'm doing for Anna here is a really nice Damascus, which is made of multiple types of steel. So anyways, what we're going to go ahead and do is show you how to work some of this stuff. You have this to hold the ring into place. You have this to hold your gem into place. Now, here's your rotation disc. And the way you get that to rotate is by lifting this bar up. I want you to listen for the click. I've got mine set for 6 clicks. Can you count them? I don't know if you hear the 6 or not, but there's 6 clicks to it. That's right here. And to adjust that, you could actually adjust it, which is going to give you the space between characters right here, or the height of it right here. That's what those two are for. Now, once you have that in place, you probably never even have to play with it again. The other place to work with that, I'm going to move this needle out of the way, is down here. If I loosen up this wing nut and I screw it upwards, it's going to give less tension on this spring rod. And so when I go like this, it's going to travel less of a distance, which means there's not going to be as much of a space between fonts or characters. If it may only go 1, 2, 1, 2, instead of the 6 that I've got. You're also going to remember that you're going to be able to put, you would put less characters on your customer's ring. Now, in my case, I've got it set just like as if it came off a computer or a typewriter or whatever you want to say, but it looks like a standard print. And I get approximately 25 characters all around, and you got to remember that counts for not just characters, but spaces and symbols. Symbols would be like hearts or your and sign, an apper sign, a hyphen, a dash, a period, anything like that is going to be a symbol. A space between lettering counts. It's going to rotate the ring further. And what you don't want it to do is tell your customer that you could do, let's say, 34 characters, and you end up overwriting the previous characters. That's what I'm trying to get at. Now, one thing I look at when I place my ring into here is stuff like this. Now, when I make my rings, my ring bands, I don't know if you can see this or not, I actually will put often a little logo. And I've got a little logo sign in here showing patriotcoinrings.com. And that's my company logo. Now, I want to make sure that, because the rotation goes clockwise, that when I do this, I start just after that sign. And if I know that it's 25 characters, I'm going to start just after. If I know it's going to be 15 characters, I give it a little bit of a space because I want to try to get it nice and even across here with this on the bottom. What you don't want to do is make the mistake, and I've done it 100 times, where I just kind of like work fast. I go ahead and I put my ring into place, and I start engraving, and what I do is you end up writing over the top of the company logo. And in your case, if you're using this and it says, let's say from another company, it says tungsten or titanium, like I laser engrave on my rings, letting the customer know what it is. You want to stay away from that so that you don't write over the top of it, because it totally ruins your customer's writing and engraving. All right, so before I get started, we're going to finish up the little review. I've finished up. The last one was with this, and this one is the adjustment of space between characters. All right, now, to make that rotation, it's upwards. Now we're going to cover something a little bit different. Let's say I want the double hearts. I'm going to pull this lever up that pulls that arrow up, and I can rotate the disc as much as I want, and we're going to go for that double heart, and I'm going to put it in place. Now, I want to make sure that locks into place and it's not loose. Do you hear how it locked into place? Okay, let's do that again. Okay, it actually locks. All right, now I want to make sure that my pin is right on inside the engraving. And you might notice a little white grease on there. That's exactly what that is. I use Lucas white grease. You use WD-40. I just noticed that without it, it was actually cutting up my brass disc here. All right, and I had to buy. I've bought a couple from the company just to replace. All right, you're gonna put it in place, and you got to push down, and then with your ring in place, that's when you push down on this, and you'll notice how it rises. What it's doing is it's pushing that ring up against this carbide bit, which is adjustable and removable if you ever have to replace it. And once it pushes it up nice and hard up against that ring, I'm able to actually start inscribing what I see here. And what I'm writing down here at the bottom is actually happening up at the top where my ring is. And I could go over and over. Now, in your instructions, you're going to notice that it says only do it one time. That's because they want to avoid any liability that, let's say, it makes duplicate lines. And that would only occur if your disc was loose. And if your disc is loose and it shakes out of place, then yeah, if you're going over the line once, and then you go a second time and it shakes out of place, now you're going to have a double line in there. That happened to me until I adjusted my disc. And I got that nice and fixed in there. So now what I do is I'll actually go over it several times so that I get a nice deep great engraving on my customers' rings. Now, that is what you do when you're engraving. You push down, I engrave. And when you get ready to lift this arm, make sure that you continue to hold the pin in place. Do not let it go. If you let it go, when I let this go, that pin is going to scratch right across your ring and scar it really bad. What I do is I hold it in place, I easily let that up, and then I'm able to let that pin up. Obviously, I got company. Okay, so now what we want to do is go ahead and get started on Anna's ring. And we're going to go ahead and put Always and Forever on there for you, Anna, and make a really nice ring. Let's go ahead and put this into action. Remember, we're going to start with the company logo, and I do have an actual upside to it. The eagle, it's a picture of an eagle, and it says Patriot Coin Rings in there. And I want to make sure that my lettering is also facing in the same direction, not upside down. So let's go ahead and open this up. And then I'm going to rotate back to lock that in place. All right, and we're good to go. All right, Alexa, play Always and Forever for us.
Always and Forever by Heatwave.
Okay, we got to make a space now. I just typed Always. To do that, I'm going to go 1, 2. And we're going to get that and sign in there. One, two. I'm going to start on the word forever. finished. You can see it starts off with my company logo, and then I left a nice little space, always, and forever. You see a little bit of those metal shavings, so let's just clean that out. Just do that with your finger. So the machine does make a really nice engraving. Well, hopefully you found the video somewhat useful and it helps you out if you decide to buy one, or if you own one and you're just kind of curious on how to use it, that it helps you out. And I appreciate you visiting us to see one of our videos. If you're interested in making coin rings or titanium, tungsten, or any other kind of bands, feel free to go on and look at our channel and take a look at all over the other videos that we got. And if you are a ring maker, definitely subscribe. If you're a customer, subscribe. I really appreciate it, but there's a lot of videos that you can actually take a look at, and they're really kind of enjoyable to watch. I've got about 100 videos that I got to upload to YouTube that I haven't done it. I just haven't had the time, but hopefully I will soon. All right, you guys, thanks a lot for visiting. Mike at Patriot Coin Rings, take care. Oh yeah, and I wanted to throw in this last tip. Obviously, you're gonna have some errors. Sometimes you get typos, scratches on your rings. Save them, don't throw them away. Just all you gotta do is tape them up. This is a heat sink tape, and I have this for a powder coating system. All I do is I powder coat the insides of these rings where it has the engraving. I put them up here in my powder coating system, and they will look like they're brand spanking new after I finish up. So now you save your rings. You don't have to throw them away. Hopefully that helps out, and you have a wonderful day. Subscribe.